Hello, I'm Mohammed Noor. I'm a professor of biology at Duke University, and I'm an occasional science consultant for the Star Trek universe. I'm really excited to talk with you today about natural history on the planet Kaminar. So we got to see Kaminar in season 2 of Star Trek Discovery, and I want to explore some of the biology of the species that we see there on Kaminar and compare and contrast to biology that we see on Earth. So let's go ahead and get started. What is natural history? So you've probably heard about natural history in the context of museums, but natural history is the study of living beings through observation rather than through experimentation. So given that we obviously cannot experiment on Kelpiens or other species from Kaminar, we have to observe them and infer a little bit about their biology. Now let's focus on the species that we see the most on Kaminar, which is the Kelpien. Kelpiens are obviously animals, they're clearly not plants or fungi. They appear to be vertebrates. We saw a scan in this episode of Saru's backbone, and we could see it there on the screen. And it appears to be a mammal, as far as we can tell. They're not especially hairy, but looking at Sarana and some of the other Kelpiens, they appear to have mammary glands. So let's dig in based on what we see regarding Saru in particular. So Saru has some senses that humans do not have. So for one thing, he seems to have this spidey sense for danger. And you see his little retractable threat ganglia come out and dangle when he is threatened. So are there species like that on Earth? The coolest example I could think of is the African pygmy hedgehog, which balls up into a ball and extrudes its little spikes when it's threatened. Very cute. Love those things. Saru also seems to have the ability to smell emotion or anticipation. We saw this in the very beginning of season 2 when he sensed that Michael Burnham was a little bit anxious about seeing her brother Spock. Now, in fact, we do, as humans, exude some scents that depict our emotions. There was a study done not too long ago where sweat samples were taken from individuals that were watching either a scary movie or a not very scary movie. And then those samples, maybe off t-shirts, were given to their dogs. And the scientists tested how their dogs reacted. And interestingly, the dogs reacted in a way that mirrored what their owners saw in terms of the movie. So if they saw a scary movie, the dogs exhibited more signs of stress, or if they saw a calm movie, they seemed calmer. So that's pretty cool. Another thing about Kelpiens is they seem to have what's referred to as a wider optical window, some sort of better vision. Now what that means is they can see further into ultraviolet or infrared light than humans can. Now this is actually quite common in a lot of species here on Earth. One interesting example is kestrels can see the ultraviolet signals associated with rodent urine, and they use that to home in and catch their prey. One new thing that came about this season was us learning about their Kelpien's metamorphosis, or vahar'ai. Now, before the vahar'ai, the Kelpiens tended to be very fearful all the time, whereas after the vahar'ai, they lose their threat ganglia and are much bolder. Now, this is referred to in the episode by some of the crew of Discovery as an evolution. They talked about post-evolution or evolved Kelpiens and pre-evolution Kelpiens. Now, it's not really that precise. So here's a picture of me as a young child. I obviously look different than I do today. Although I have changed over that time, that is not considered evolution, since evolution is thought to be change over generations, not within an individual or within generations. Similarly, you wouldn't call a caterpillar a pre-evolution butterfly, for example. These are all just developmental changes. Nonetheless, these sorts of metamorphoses are sometimes associated with other sorts of changes like diet or behavior. In the case of Kelpiens, we know their diet seems to be mostly kelp when they're young. And maybe what happens is after the evolution is they feast on Ba'ul burgers. No, I'm just kidding. We know there was some hostility there between the Kelpiens and Ba'ul and that they were knocking the Ba'ul back. We don't know that they were eating them. Nonetheless, if that was the case, we see something similar on Earth in the context of a lot of tadpoles of various frog species are primarily herbivorous. They'll eat like vegetation. Whereas frogs in general tend to be very carnivorous. They'll eat things like insects or other small animals. Now, one really shocking thing that we saw in this particular episode was a new mode of defense by Kelpiens, where they can actually shoot little spikes at something that's threatening them. That's pretty cool. Now, on Earth, the example you might think of is the porcupine. In fact, that's a misnomer. Porcupines cannot shoot their quills. They can kind of shake them out and have them come out that way, but they can't actually shoot them at a predator. The closest thing to it might be a tarantula, but even tarantulas just kind of emit off various hairs. They don't actually shoot them in a particular direction. The coolest example I saw of something shooting a defense at a particular direction is the bombardier beetle, which sprays boiling hot chemicals at its attacker. That is scary. And finally, in this episode, we learned that there was a change in the predator-prey dynamics on Kaminar over time. So 2,000 years ago, it appears that there were a lot more Kelpians out there, and the Ba'ul were actually very much threatened with extinction. What's happened over the last 2,000 years is the Ba'ul were able to recover, and the Kelpians are now subjugated by these advanced Ba'ul. So something like this may have happened many tens of millions of years ago on Earth. So if you go back, say, 100 million years ago, Earth was dominated by dinosaurs, and while there were mammals, they were probably hiding from these giant predators. And following some extreme catastrophic events, such as an asteroid impact and a lot of volcanic activity, now we see mammals are very abundant. They've diversified quite a bit all across the planet. So it's quite a bit of change has happened over this time. And maybe something similar happened on Kaminar, where a catastrophic event perhaps knocked back the Kelpians and allowed the Ba'ul to achieve their dominance. Another possibility is that the Ba'ul embraced technology much earlier than the Kelpians. That allowed them to take over the planet. We humans have certainly done that on Earth over the last 100 years or so.
Were you surprised about any of the biology on Kaminar or about the Kelpians in particular? Let me know in the comments. And thank you again for tuning in to BioTrekkie Explains. Come back next time.